Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we are joined by D. Raghunandan from the Delhi Science Forum to talk about the most recent explosion of the SpaceX Starship series. This time it was the SN10, which exploded right after landing. And this was the third such explosion which has happened since SpaceX has started testing its Starship series since December. So Raghu, thank you for joining us today. Can you first tell us about this craft itself? You know, what does it do? Why is it being built?
Yeah. So the Starship is a spacecraft meant to be taken for interplanetary travel to the moon or to Mars, for example, and have enough power so that it can take off from the moon and come back to the Earth, or it can take off from Mars and come back to the Earth. So this is just the spacecraft. It's an extremely powerful spaceship, as you can imagine, because it must have the power to, while it's on the moon or on Mars, to take off from there directly to Earth. Now, if you remember the moon shots with NASA's shots with Neil Armstrong and others, it had an orbiting craft and a lunar module which landed on the moon, took off from the moon only up to the spacecraft, which then brings it back to Earth. This guy, this spacecraft, is designed to, from the moon or from Mars, directly boost and come all the way back to Earth. So you can, as you can imagine, it's a very powerful craft. But to add to this, this is meant to be the spaceship, but it will sit on top of a extremely powerful rocket, which is also undergoing tests currently. And the first prototype flight is still to take place, which will actually carry this spaceship to the moon or to Mars. Once it is, the spacecraft has left Earth's orbit, this main rocket will come back in the now well-established SpaceX tradition of making a soft landing back on Earth, the typical vertical landing that we have seen, which is now common across SpaceX's launches. All their satellite launches, near-Earth orbit launches are done that way. So you can imagine this spaceship is by itself a big guy, and it's going to sit on top of a even more powerful rocket, which will be used multiple times. So as you said, this is the third of these crafts which is being tried out. There are several. This is serial number 10. And each of them has gone through various modifications and changes. And unfortunately, till now, we have not yet seen a successful launch. We are still to talk about the rocket itself, which is not even the first prototype has been tried. Since you're going to be talking about the explosion, I'll cover some related aspects there.
Right. So that's what I was going to ask. Next, can you tell us about why these explosions have been happening?
Well, why is still... I can't give a definitive answer till we actually get an answer from SpaceX itself, because I'm sure they are analyzing all the what happened and so on. But what one can make out from the videos of the landing is, this is SN10. SN8 and 9 also had a hard landing vertically. When it came back, it did not just smoothly land and slow down, but it crashed while it landed. This guy seems to have almost made a soft landing, although there are some doubts on that, because at the bottom of the craft are three kind of landing legs, which it is supposed to land on. None of the videos I've seen, you can see these landing legs. So maybe there was a problem in deploying those, but it seems to have had also a fairly rough landing, because it landed and then it tilted slightly. So you can see the spaceship being slightly tilted, and flames coming out at the bottom of the spaceship. So it looks as if maybe the landing was a bit hard. It jolted the inner components and structure of the spacecraft. Some fuel may have leaked from somewhere, from the tanks. And because of the hard landing and the fire that you see below, the fuel leak must have got ignited and led to this explosion.
Right. And what we see is that the feedback or the response to these explosions until now has been that these are not necessarily a bad thing, that, you know, this gives SpaceX an opportunity to collect data and to then improve on the technology. So what do you think of this sort of response?
Well, there's two aspects to it. Of course, rocketry is not an easy technology to master. And if one goes back into the history of NASA's rockets, into the Soviet launches, in the early days, we never got to hear about what happened with Soviet launches until much later. And if you see even the Indian launches, we have had a large number of failures before you finally succeed in a regularized workhorse rocket. Today, for example, SpaceX's Falcon rocket, or even the Falcon Heavy rocket, which is now routinely goes off, launches satellites, or carries crew to the space station and comes back safely. So that is now a well-established technology, and it's now become a workhorse for SpaceX. But this also had its teething troubles to begin with. It had its teething troubles to begin with. The additional problem with SpaceX and the personality of Elon Musk, if you like, is that with this spaceship, he has set himself extremely ambitious targets. His target is to take a manned crew to the moon and back, a manned craft to the moon and back by 2023. That's just 3 years away. And imagine where we are today with not even one successful launch. So with a looming deadline hardly 3 years away, Musk is clearly pushing it while at the same time innovating in the craft. Now, even under normal circumstances and with any other technology, rapid innovation, large-scale innovation, along with tight timelines is, as you can imagine, put strain on the entire system and can certainly lead to crashes. And I'm sure this is one of the contributing factors to these crashes that we have seen, because the team must be under pressure to deliver quickly. So one of the, to my mind, answer to SpaceX's troubles with these would be to elongate the time frame. If you give yourself time till 25 or 2026, then I think you would see fewer crashes of this nature, because after every crash, you need to have sufficient time to analyze, rectify, and then launch. With 8, 9, and 10, that does not seem to have happened. More or less, the same things are happening now. Of course, we don't know the technical details from inside the establishment, from inside SpaceX. And Elon Musk is notoriously tight about divulging technical details. One of the reasons for which is, by the way, Elon Musk is also averse to patenting. He doesn't patent many of his technologies, but in order to do the innovations that he does quickly and usefully, he has to keep a very tight lid on the technical information. So that's one reason why from outside, we may not get too many technical details of what happens inside SpaceX. But as I said, I feel that the tight schedule that he has given himself, plus the number of innovations that he's trying out on this craft, add to these problems. One such innovation, I'll just as an example I'll give you, is he has changed the body of the spaceship. And if you see the videos, you'll see it glistening and glimmering in the sunlight, because the craft is made out of stainless steel. While normally one would have gone with carbon fiber or some such. But Musk, of course, as you know, wants to cut costs in terms of space launches. And he has come to the conclusion that carbon fiber ultimately ends up costing about $200 per kilo, whereas he can use stainless steel to build the rocket or the spaceship at about $3 to $5 a kilo. So he's pushing that as well. And that may lead to some of these things, because carbon fiber is more resilient and a material, while stainless steel can tend to be a little rigid and hard. So that's contributory factor. So like I was just giving that as an example to show that you try a number of innovations while at the same time you give yourself a tight time schedule. I think this is putting too much pressure on the system. Thank you.